So friends, welcome to the 155th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. The journey continues. We have been getting ourselves exposed to different thoughts, ideas, and different viewpoints. Yesterday, we were exposed to geographical indications. Now, we are going on to the other end altogether in the sense like we have a topic, extent of the power of a special judge under the Prevention of Corruption Act to render pardon to an accomplice. We have our own, the coroner of our family, Justice Ram Kumar sir, to deliver this, the lecture. And we are privileged with the presence of Justice Ramushan sir, Justice Kondaram sir, and all of you wonderful participants. So without wasting any time, we'll go directly to Justice Ram Kumar sir. So over to you.
Thank you, Shyam. Good afternoon, friends. It is a slightly controversial subject in the sense that the case law on the point is confusing and at variance and not very helpful in resolving the confusion. The offenses relating to bribery and corruption among public servants were originally dealt with under the Indian Penal Code. Sections 161 to 165A of Indian Penal Code were those offenses dealing with bribery and corruption. But the post-World War fallouts facilitated wider scope for corrupt practices. Impelled by the felt necessity for curbing and stamping out this escalating evil of corruption, the Parliament enacted the Prevention of Corruption Act 1947. This act, however, borrowed mainly the very same offenses under the Indian Penal Code, namely sections 161 to 165A. The definition of public servant also was borrowed from section 21 of the Indian Penal Code. The aforesaid offenses, however, continued to be tried by magistrates as before. In the year 1949, the Government of India set up a committee headed by Bakshi Tek Chand. I think he was the judge of Lahore. Lahore, I could have seen some of his judgments. Inter alia, to examine the measure of success achieved by the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act 1946 in combating corruption. Thereafter, with a view to provide for the speedy trial of the aforesaid offenses, the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952 was passed by the Parliament, stipulating inter alia that the aforesaid offenses would be tried by special courts. For the first time, special courts were sought to be established for trying offenses. But offenses continued to be the same, to be presided over by session judges or additional session judges. The procedure continued to be warrant procedure. Section 8 of the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952 is almost identical with Section 5.2 of the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988. That is, a special judge can take cognizance of the offense without a committal. To that extent, it goes against Section 193. Even though presiding judge is a session judge, he can take cognizance without a committal. Then under Section 8.2, special judge was also given power to tender pardon to an accomplice. Subsection 3, there's a presumption, deeming provision, whereby he is deemed to be a session court as well as a magistrate for certain purposes. Then the subsequent appointment of Sandhanam Committee, there was another committee by name Sandhanam Committee in the year 1962, that was a landmark in the crusade against corruption. The said committee made exhaustive inquiries and submitted a very comprehensive report. Based on the recommendations of Sandhanam Committee, the Anti-Corruption Laws Amendment Act 1964, followed by Criminal Law Amendment Amending Act 1966, Anti-Corruption Laws Amendment Act 1967, etc., were inter alia passed, finally culminating in the enactment of the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988. In this new act, the penal provisions were separately provided and redefined. One, quite unusually, the PC Act 1988 does not specify the date from which it shall come into force. Very often you will find in Section 1 or 2 that this act shall come into force either at one or on such date as the government may notify, etc. Such a section is not there. The act was published in the Official Gazette on 12-9-1988. So which will be the date of commencement of the act?
Date of publication, normally, if it is not
12-9-1988. That is the usual mistake committed by us. In fact, it is not the date of publication. It is the date on which President grants the assent to the statute. That was on 9-9-1988. So the act came into force by virtue of Section 5 of the General Clauses Act. Act came into force on 9-9-1988. So it was published on 12-9-1988. Now the object of tendering pardon to an accomplice. The object of tendering pardon to an accomplice is with a view to obtaining the evidence of any person supposed to have been directly or indirectly concerned in or privy to an offense. Section 306(1) itself gives the indication. Now, I am not reading Section 306. It's a very long section. Therefore, Section 306(1) can be read. Clause 1.
So with a
view, with a view to
obtaining the evidence of any person
supposed to have been directly or indirectly concerned in or privy to an offense to which this section applies, the chief judicial magistrate or a metropolitan magistrate, see the wording, the chief judicial magistrate or a metropolitan magistrate. See, in any metropolitan area, any metropolitan magistrate will do. Whereas in a non-metropolitan area, the chief, even if there is a plurality of chief judicial magistrates, additional chief judicial magistrate, the chief judicial magistrate, at any stage of the investigation or inquiry into or the trial of the offense, and the magistrate of the first class inquiring into or trying the offense, at any stage of the inquiry or trial, may tender a pardon to such person on condition of his making a full and true disclosure of the whole of the circumstances within his knowledge relating to the offense and to every other person concerned, whether as a principal or abettor in the commission. Therefore, that is enough. That's enough for our purpose.
Yes.
Now, can you remove the screen sharing?
Sure.
Now, after the salutary principle behind it has been the subject of judicial elucidation. The salutary principle behind the tender of pardon is that in many cases, the crime is committed in such a manner that no clue or trace is left behind by the offenders, thereby rendering it difficult for the agencies engaged in the detection of crimes to get at the offenders. And the incriminating objects, unless the participant of the crime himself comes forward to reveal the details of the crime so that the major offenders also can be brought to book and punished. The basis of tendering pardon to an accomplice is to prevent the escape of offenders from punishment in heinous crimes due to lack of evidence. The citations are Suresh Chandra Bahri versus State of Bihar, AR 1994 Supreme Court 2420, then State of Maharashtra versus Abu Salem Abdul Qayyum Ansari 2010, 10 SEC 179. Now, if you go further in Section 304, the offenses in respect of which pardon can be tendered, as per the scheme of the CRPC, the various stages of a criminal case are the following. First is investigation. It can be investigation either by the police or by non-police agencies. Then comes, they may, after investigation, file a charge sheet. or if it is a non-police officer, he may file a complaint. Then there is the initiation of proceedings. Then comes the next stage. The magistrate applies his mind to the charge sheet or the complaint. Inquiry. Second stage is inquiry. Then after the conclusion of inquiry, we come to the last stage, namely trial. Now, going by the wordings of subsections 1 and 2 of section 306 CRPC, pardon can be tendered to an accomplice at any of the three stages referred to above. Now, section 306, if you closely peruse 306.2, the offenses for which pardon can be tendered are any offense triable exclusively by the court of session. So, offenses which are exclusively triable by a court of session, the pardon can be tendered. Then next is any offense exclusively triable by a special judge appointed under the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952. See, both are clubbed together. Special, the court of session or the special judge appointed under the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952. Then, lastly, any offense punishable with imprisonment, which may extend to 7 years or with a more severe sentence. How do you distinguish between this? Which may extend to 7 years. So it can be 1 year, two years, is it not? Which can extend to 7 years or with a more severe sentence. Is there any inelegance in the drafting? At first blush, you may think that there is some inelegance in the drafting. Which may extend to 7 years means it can be 1 year, 2 years, up to 7 years. And with more severe sentence also. So why? But there are offenses which may be punishable up to 3 years, up to 5 years. But this offense should be punishable at least with up to 7 years and more. That could be the reason why such a phraseology has been used. Then, now you can remove the screen share. Sure.
Yes, sir.
Now, where the offense is triable by a special court, now we are only confined in this articulation about the powers of a special court, either during investigation or during inquiry or during trial. PC Act 1988 also contains Section 5, which is identical to Section 8 of the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952. In this context, about the power of the special judge to tender pardon to an accomplice at the stage of inquiry, investigation, inquiry, and trial. See, as in the case of Section 8.2 of the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952, which we have already seen, the Section 5.2 of the PC Act 1988 also does not say that the special judge can tender pardon to an accomplice at any stage. It does not use the word at any stage. In contradistinction, under Section 306.1, that section CRPC, it gives the power to the CJM or Metropolitan Magistrate to tender pardon to an accomplice at any stage of the investigation, inquiry, or trial. Therefore, there is a wide power given to the CJM or Metropolitan Magistrate to tender pardon even during the investigation. In fact, CJM or the Metropolitan Magistrate alone are given the power to tender pardon to an accused during the stage of investigation. No other court can give tender pardon during the stage of investigation except this CJM or the Metropolitan Magistrate. Knowing this difference in the phraseology in the two sections, that is in Section 8.2 and Section 5.2 and 306.1, a three-judge bench of the Supreme Court in paragraph 8 of Commander Pascal Fernandez, Lieutenant versus State of Maharashtra, AIR 1968 Supreme Court 594, three judges, mind you, observed as follows. It is obvious that the powers of the special judge commences only after he has taken cognizance of the case and they are available to him throughout thereafter. Therefore, he gets his power only after cognizance. As we noticed under the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952 as well as Section 5.2 of PC Act 1988, the special judge was given the power to take cognizance without a committal. There is no need for a committal under Section 193 CRPC. Therefore, without a committal, he can take cognizance. But he has been appointed, special judge has been appointed only for trial. Therefore, his jurisdiction commences only after he takes cognizance of the offense. In fact, following this three-judge ruling, the High Court of Kerala, speaking through Justice Thomas P. Joseph, in Ananta Narayana Bhatt versus Central Bureau of Investigation, 2009 4 KLT 992, corresponding to 2010 Criminal Law Journal 926, has taken the same view that his jurisdiction starts only after taking cognizance. Until then, it is for the CJM. During the stage of investigation, if it is a non-metropolitan area, the Chief Judicial Magistrate alone can tender pardon to an accomplice during the stage of investigation. The power of the special judge commences only when he takes cognizance of the offense. In fact, this is a case where our friend Mr. Prem Raj had appeared.
Correct.
Now, let us examine the mechanics of the interplay between 306 CRPC and 5.2 of the PCI Act 1988. Going by the aforesaid interpretation by the three-judge bench of the Supreme Court, if the offense is triable by the special judge under PCI Act 1988, and if the stage of the case is investigation, then the Chief Judicial Magistrate in a non-metropolitan area and Metropolitan Magistrate in a metropolitan area alone shall tender pardon to an accomplice at the stage of investigation in view of Section 306 Clauses 1 and 3 CRP. If the case triable by the special court is during the stage of investigation. And thereafter, going by the procedure, the CJM shall make over the case to the appropriate magistrate who is competent to take cognizance of the offense. And such magistrate shall examine the approver, they examine the accomplice as a witness under Section 306-4A CRPC, and then commit the case to the court of session. You may wonder, why committal when the special judge himself is given the power to take cognizance without a committal? Why committal? Now, this is the area of confusion, gray area of confusion. In fact, I don't find any confusion except in the case law. There is some confusing case law. Actually, if the tender of pardon is given to the is in respect of an offense triable by a special court, is given to the accomplice during the stage of investigation, the case has to take the route under Section 306 CRP. 306 is the provision. And if the CJM or Metropolitan Magistrate tenders pardon, he will have to make over the case to the magistrate competent to commit the case to the court of session. In fact, this special judge is deemed to be a court of session also. Therefore, this CJM will have to make over the case to the magistrate competent to take cognizance, commit the case to the court of session. And that magistrate has to comply with Section 306-4A. See, Section 306-4A says that the magistrate taking cognizance of the offense shall examine the approver as a witness. And then only he can commit the case. Then he has to commit the case under Section 306-5A2 CRPC. Now there is during the subsequent trial before the special court after committal, the approver will have to be examined as a witness during the subsequent trial before the. Now this is the mechanics of a tendering pardon to in respect of an offense triable by a special court at the stage of investigation. If it is investigation stage, the special judge does not have any jurisdiction to grant. In fact, Section 5.2 has been misinterpreted by two rulings, which we'll come to. Actually, when the power of this session special judge comes starts only when he takes cognizance. He is appointed only for trial of the case. Therefore, until that stage, it is for the magisterial process to take care of the situation, take into account Section 306, 1 to 5. will apply. And after the examination of the approver under section 306(4)(a) CRPC, the committing, the magistrate taking cognizance and who is entitled to commit the case shall examine the approver as a witness. There's one more confusion added, whether the other accused in the case, whether they have got a right to cross-examine the approver at that stage. Justice U.L. Butt, in that famous Marklist scandal case, at one stage held that they have no right to cross-examine. Very same judge took a different view, saying that his earlier view was wrong. And if the accused are in attendance after summons, they have right to cross-examine the approver also, even at that stage. Then the case is committed to the session court. Then special court, I mean, special court. We say court of session under section 5.3. Then he takes cognizance on a committal, and then he conducts trial. And during the trial of the case, the accomplice will have to be examined as a witness as any other case. Until then, he is a prosecution witness. He has lost his character as as an accused, and he has become a prosecution witness. Then, if the case is under inquiry or trial, supposing the investigation is over, the special judge has taken cognizance of the offense and charge sheet has been filed before him, or a complaint has been filed before him. Case is at the stage of inquiry or trial, then magistrate has no power. The special judge himself can tender pardon in view of the power under section 5.2, which was section 8.2 under the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952. In fact, 1947 PC Act did not contain a provision enabling the special judge to tender pardon. That was introduced only by this Criminal Law Amendment Act of 1952. And the section 8 is identically worded as section 5 of the PC Act 1988. Therefore, after cognizance by the special judge, if an accused person is to be tendered pardon, if pardon has to be tendered to an accused person, after the cognizance of the case directly by this special judge, then special judge himself can do that. And it is analogous to a case where a session judge, in the case of an offense exclusively tribal by a court of session, tenders pardon under section 307 CRPC. That is why section 5.2 of PC Act says, when such pardon is granted by the special judge, it shall be deemed to have been granted under section 307 CRPC. It is almost analogous to a situation where a session judge is granting pardon and after committal. But before committal, even in the case of an offense exclusively tribal by a court of session, the tendering of pardon should be by the magistrate. And thereafter the witness will have to be examined as the approver will have to be examined as a witness during the subsequent trial before the special court. Now, the policy of law, in fact, 337 was the corresponding section under the old code of 1898. Though the wordings are slightly different, the policy of law seems to be that at the pre-trial stage, if an accomplice is tendered pardon by a magistrate, that magistrate should not try him. The trial should be by another magistrate. That seems to be the policy of law. But in a case where the accomplice is pardon tendered to an accomplice by a session judge after committal, or by the special court after taking cognizance, there is no other court. Therefore, that court itself can tender pardon, and then the examination of the approver under section 306(4)(a) is dispensed with. In a case where either the special judge directly tenders pardon after committal, after cognizance, or where the session judge tenders pardon after committal, then the examination of the approver under section 306(4)(a) by the court taking cognizance has been dispensed. If it is a committal, if it is a tendering of pardon falling under 307, then 306(4)(a) stage is dispensed with. He need not be examined by the court taking cognizance. Thereafter, he need only be tried at the appropriate stage. This seems to be the policy of law. When the CRPC came into force, present CRPC came into force on 25/1/1974, it cannot be assumed that the Parliament was unaware of Criminal Law Amendment Act of 1952, which for the first time prescribed that the special judge should try offences under the PC Act. The section 8(1) and 2, almost corresponding to sections 5(1) and 2 of PC Act 1988, specifically refer to special judge appointed under the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952. So it is not as if the Parliament was unaware of the special of the provision under the special Criminal Law Amendment Act 1952. Hence, the power of the CJM or Metropolitan Magistrate to tender pardon to an accomplice during the stage of investigation of an offence, which is triable by a special judge under the PC Act 1988, has not been affected in any way by Section 5(2). Now, the fact that there has been no legislative intervention even after the enactment of PC Act 1988 shows that legislature was fully conscious about the different routes under which tender of pardon can be, different stages under which tender of pardon can be administered, and the case how the case should take, which route the case should take to reach the special court. Now, the three-judge bench decision in Commander Pascal Fernandez's case very sharply, very categorically took notice of this distinction, and it was followed by Justice Thomas B. Joseph in Ananda Narayana Bhatt also. Then comes the Bangaru Lakshman versus State 2012 1 SEC 500 corresponding to AIR 2012 Supreme Court 873, and Mishra PC versus State CBI, that is to AIR 2014 Supreme Court 1921. Two separate two-judge benches of the Supreme Court held that this special judge has got the power to tender pardon not only after committal, not only after taking cognizance, but even during investigation. These two judge benches held that the power of the special judge is rather concurrent. It has got a concurrent power under investigation as well as during the inquiry stage also, because of the conferment of power under Section 5(2). In fact, similar power had been conferred way back in 1953-52 under Section 8. In spite of that, the three-judge bench of the Supreme Court held that no, he derives power, the special judge derives power only after taking cognizance. And before that, if an accomplice has to be tendered pardon, that can be done only under Section 306 by the CJM during investigation. Then, this Bangaru Lakshman did notice the three-judge bench, but also did notice that the both Section 8 and Section 5 are pari materia. But in spite of that, it gave a shift to the earlier provision in the CRPC to say that since the sections are differently worded, that principle cannot be upheld. In my humble view, that interpretation cannot be applied, because even under the old code, Section 337, there also the magistrate tendering pardon should not try the case. The trial should be by CJM or by the Sessions Court. The magistrate tendering pardon during investigation should not try the case. That seems to be the policy of law. Fortunately, in 2016, AIR 2016 Supreme Court 2551, CBI Chennai versus Arul Kumar, it has been very beautifully observed. In fact, the three-judge bench decision has been followed to say that it has two routes. If the tendering of pardon takes place during the stage of investigation, it has to take the route under section 306 and it has to come by way of committal to the special court. Whereas if the tendering of pardon is made by the special judge after committal, without, in fact, after, no, directly, without a committal, then only he get the power to tender pardon, and that is a different route. It need not come through 306. And not only that, the two-judge bench also clarified that if the tender of pardon has been given by the Chief Judicial Magistrate during investigation, the charge sheet should be filed before the magistrate competent to commit the case, not before the special court. Whereas, if no pardon has been tendered during investigation, then the charge sheet is to be filed before the special court, because special court can take cognizance without a committal, directly take cognizance. So see the beauty of the CRPC and the interplay of these sections. In a case where a pardon has been tendered during investigation, the CJM alone in a non-metropolitan area, CJM alone can tender pardon, and thereafter he has to make it over to the magistrate entitled to commit the case to the court of special court, which is deemed to be a court of session, and that is the route. And therefore, the charge sheet, in fact, after tendering pardon, after the pardon is tendered, the investigating agency should file the charge sheet, not before the special court, but before the magistrate entitled to commit the case to the special court. And after examining the approver under section 306-4A, by the magistrate taking cognizance of the offense, the case will have to be committed to the special court. But if after taking cognizance directly without a committal, the special judge wants to tender pardon, he can do so. Then the stage of 306-4A CRPC is dispensed with. There is no examination of the approver as a witness during the by the court taking cognizance, because it is the same court which takes cognizance, which is tendering pardon to the accomplice. Thereafter, the court can only try him, as in the case of a sessions judge tendering pardon after committal. 307 is the provision. This distinction has not been taken note of in Bengaru Lakshman and the other decision which I refer to. Therefore, in my view, in a case where the offense is tribal by a special court under PC Act 1988, and pardon to an accomplice is tendered during the stage of investigation, then the power of the Chief Judicial Magistrate or Metropolitan Magistrate to tender pardon to an accomplice under Section 306(1) and 3 is not taken away or affected by Section 5(2) of the PC Act. And in such a case, the route prescribed for the case to reach the special court is through a committal under Section 306(5A)(2) CRPC. In such a case, after tendering pardon by the CJM under Section 306(1) and 3 CRPC, the charge sheet shall be filed before the appropriate magistrate who is competent to take cognizance and commit the case to the special judge. The approver will have to be examined as a witness before such magistrate in compliance of Section 306(4)(a) CRPC. Thereafter, the said magistrate should commit the case for trial to the special judge under Section 306(5)(a)(2) CRPC. During the subsequent trial of the case before the special judge, the accomplice will have to be examined as a prosecution witness. But in a case where the offense is tribal by a special judge under the PC Act, and if pardon to an accomplice is tendered not during the stage of investigation, the charge sheet shall be filed directly before the special court, and the special judge can take cognizance of the offense without a committal. After cognizance of the offense, if the special judge wants to tender pardon to an accomplice, he can do so and there is no need for compliance of Section 306(4)(a) CRPC, and the accomplice need only be examined as a prosecution witness during the subsequent trial of the case. This is because of the fiction under Section 5(2) of the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988. The provision is almost analogous to a pardon being tendered by the session judge after committal. And according to me, in my humble view, the verdicts passed by the Supreme Court in Bangaru Lakshman and Mishra PC may require a reconsideration by a larger bench, especially in the light of the three-judge bench in Pascar Fernandez, as well as in the case of Arul Kumar, state of CBI, Chennai versus Arul Kumar, 2016, Supreme Court 2551. According to me, this later decision of Supreme Court 2016 lays down the law very correctly. And this is my take on tendering pardon to an accomplice by the special judge and various stages of tendering pardon. If it is during investigation, special judge does not have the jurisdiction. If it is after taking cognizance, then only the power of the special judge to take cognizance to tender pardon to an accomplice will arise. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Let us Kondaram sir. Is...
No.
Oh, 1 second. Kondaram sir, please. You let unmute. Justice Kondaram, I think you may have to unmute at your end.
Still under mute.
Still under mute. Yes, sir. Please.
Sir, the subject is Greek and Latin to me, sir. To be honest, I didn't know that the accomplice can be given pardon.
We see that, Raman.
So I'm learning. That's why, in fact, the topic interested me because of that. I was not a criminal and criminal lawyer.
Unlike me. I was a civil lawyer.
No, you are converted. He was converted.
Turned a confirmed criminal.
Thank you, sir. I'll go straight to Justice Ramushan, sir.
Really, it's a, what do you call, a nice lecture on a subject where...
Our judicial officers are in the dark. Many of them are in the dark regarding this procedure.
Sir, today because, we have a couple of our district judges here. There is Kamini sir is there, Rajakumara sir is there, Manjula madam is there.
I see. And what do you say, Mr. Ajit Kumar? After Justice Ramoshan, Ajit Kumar can. He is the CBI standing counsel for CBI. He can.
Really, it's a new subject, we can say, because I don't think that any of the PC Act judges who are trying the PC Act cases have opportunity to invoke these provisions, etc. Because normally, for committal or something like that, it will be being done from the CJM side itself. They will be doing there during investigation itself. They are doing it, and thereafter only they are
bringing. No, there have been cases where special judge has tendered pardon during investigation.
Yes.
And there have been cases where, probably. Ajit Kumar may be able to say
I never set as a trial judge, but only for a few months, I can say, or one term or so, I was hearing the PC Act cases. At that time, this question has not arisen, so that there is no opportunity for me to go into those questions. Also, the legality of the pardon card granted, etc., etc. Anyhow, it's a informative lecture given by Ramkumar sir, who is I can say competent to give such lectures. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Ajit Kumar sir, please.
Yes. Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Sir, I sustained a conviction for a village officer. I was a village officer. I was a prosecutor for having received a bribe of 2,000 rupees picked up from the document writer. Document writer ultimately, as is often is the case, he went into the shoes of the vigilance for us. And he became an approver. His statement was recorded by the magistrate, by the special judge during the stage of investigation. Right. Later on, a final report was filed by the special judge vigilance. And when the final report came, I came up to the High Court with the same arguments. I did not go through all this decision that you said. But anyway, just by looking at this provision, I had a doubt that the procedures were wrong. So ultimately, as is often, the High Court never granted me a stay. I went for trial, sustained a conviction, and I am now in appeal. Now I asked the, so that is why I came to your lordship with the same subject 2 weeks back. But then thereafter, sir, Then you referred to me to the problem with respect to the Bengaluru election case. Bengaluru election case I looked up. Then also the 2016 decision and also the Misra case. But then, sir, I want to ask you one thing, which I am likely to be confronted by in the court. Sir, they in those decisions, especially I think it is in Misra case, they refer to a three-judge judgment in Harshad Mehta's. Have you gone through that, sir?
No.
Same situation arose in, they say that in one judgment, I have not read that Harshad Mehta's case, but they say the same question arose in Harshad Mehta's case. And in Harshad Mehta's case, the special court was trying them. Then also they refer to a case under the TADA, but they did not refer to a special decision.
Fernandez.
Where,
Pascal Fernandez, was it referred to?
No, Pascal Fernandez was referred to. Pascal Fernandez was referred to in the manner that you said. They said that Pascal Fernandez said that power was there for the special judge to give pardon to the approver during the stage of investigation, which is not the correct position.
Yes, the words at any stage.
Yes. Correct, sir. But it seems that the Supreme Court has quoted Pascal Fernandez in a wrong way. But then, sir, there is a decision which they relied on in Harshad Mehta's case.
And
that happens to a three-judge bench.
Now, who is the judge?
That has to be
the judge who pronounced. Who is the judge in?
Harshad Mehta's case.
Not Harshad Mehta. The PC.
Yes, sir. That judgment is the Harshad Mehta judgment is referred to in one of the judgments that you right now cited.
I'll look into it. That. Thank
sir.
You for
sir. Then that Misra
PC, in that Misra PC 2014 Supreme Court, the judgment was pronounced by a judge who did not have sufficient exposure to criminal law. In fact,
there were a lordship of the High Courts.
You can say that there are other other erroneous judgments by the same judge, including Anil Kumar versus Ayyappan.
Sir, all that you can say, sir. Sir, then another question I want to ask. Sir, now I understand that the whole premise starts from the proposition that there is no question of granting the status of an approver unless and until you are a magistrate and you take cognizance of an offense. Am I right?
I didn't get you.
The whole basis, that is the whole foundation of the talk that you right now said regarding this approver, etc.
Yes.
You can confer the status of an approver to an accused person only if you are, number one, you are a magistrate. Number two, you have to take cognizance of the office. If you don't take cognizance, you cannot give approver. Am I correct?
Not in all cases. For example, if the offense has been taken cognizance of by the special judge, without a committal,
sir, I did not make myself clear. Yes. Sir, that the basic foundation for giving the status of an approver to an accused person is that you take cognizance of the offense. Thereafter, you give him the status of an approver, provided the other conditions are fulfilled. Is that the law, sir?
No. He gets the status of approver even before that.
No, sir. Sir, if that is not the law, sir, then cognizance is not mandatory for giving the status of an approver.
No, that is the reason why no. Because if that be the case, if such a stand is taken during investigation, this power could not be taken at all.
Pardon, sir?
For the purpose of investigation, such a power is not given to the magistrate who is maybe entitled to take cognizance. Maybe that may be the reason we will not interpret in that way.
But it is only during the stage of investigation if pardon has been tendered, then the magistrate taking cognizance should examine him as a witness. During that examination, if he recoils from the promise given by him,
Sir, allow me to elaborate a little further.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Sir, I am an accused. I am an accused. Whether there are other accused, I am now taken to the magistrate under a sponsorship for recording my approval statement.
Yes.
Then I say you cannot take my statement because you have not taken cognizance of. Can I say that?
No.
Why? Sir, if that is the case, then that is the case, sir. Are we not saying impliedly that without a cognizance, you can give status to an approver. So therefore, the special judge can definitely record the statement during the investigation.
The special judge is established, constituted only for trial. When does trial start?
Sir, I want light on this. I understood your point. A point taken. Sir, the point that I am asking you in return, sir, because I am likely to be confronted. Sir, if the point that you said is right, sir, and if that is the law, sir, then let me ask
you,
sir.
Don't you agree?
I have a doubt, sir. Sir, but suppose you are the special judge. I am arrested and brought before you in a trap case. I say you have no jurisdiction to touch me because you take cognizance only after trial, only after final report itself. Then I am saying that you have no right to remind me. Right to grant me bail or not to grant me bail, you cannot do anything with me.
How can you
because
say that?
This is investigation. Because you are only you, because the case is under investigation, sir.
All right, but then the question of
then how do you grant me bail, sir, or how do you remand me? How do you exercise power under Section 167?
Do you mean to say that when a magistrate applies his mind on a remand report and remands the accused to under 167, he is taking cognizance?
Okay, sir. If he is not taking cognizance,
why do you say if he cannot? He can take cognizance only on the four sources mentioned under Section 190. One is police report.
Yes, right.
Here it is right, only right. FIR stage, crime stage. It has to ripen into a final report.
Okay.
Charge sheet. Then only he can take cognizance. So when during the crime
stage, Sir, does the same principle hold good with respect to recording the statement of an approver? That in order to record the statement of an approver, you have to take cognizance. Are you saying that the question of cognizance does not arise at all? The power of granting an approver status rests only within the borders of Section 306.
Instead of that power being given to the police, how does the magistrate get the power to record a 164.5 statement? Statement under the 164?
By being sponsored.
Is it after taking cognizance?
No.
During investigation?
Yes, sir.
Likewise, a power to tender pardon is given to a judicial personage because the police may misuse that power. That is why that power is not given to the police. Therefore, that power is given to the magistrate. And law does not, even 306 does not contemplate cognizance before tendering pardon to an accomplice. Okay. After tendering pardon only, the question of cognizance will arise. And examination of the approver before the magistrate taking cognizance. Even that is not necessary if pardon is tendered under Section 307 after committal, after cognition.
That point taken, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I am just asking you a hypothetical situation. Sir, I am putting up the same point before you and you are sitting up in appeal before. Then, sir, how will I get up? Sir, will you be bold enough to say that the other...
You should not argue a case in respect of a pending case.
Sir, allow me to complete. You have understood what I'm going to ask. Yeah. I know. Sir, allow me to complete.
Pending case should not be argued.
Sir, allow me to argue, sir. Allow me to complete it, sir. Sir, my only respectful submission is this. Sir, suppose I come before you, before a lordship, and if you are fully convinced that Bengaluru Lakshman was... Parent Kuria, will you say that? Will you have the boldness to say that?
You don't know me.
I don't know. I am just asking you.
Oh, as if you are seeing me for the first time.
No, sir. I just wanted to know how another judge will react to the same thing. That is why I am asking.
If I am the judge, I would have definitely said that this special judge had no jurisdiction to tender pardon at the stage of investigation. I am only on first principles. Leave alone Bengaluru Lakshman or even Pascal Fernandez. Leave alone all those decisions. First principles.
So, therefore, Bengaluru Junction is parent curiam.
Don't argue that before the...
No. He is entitled to argue, but whether it can be accepted or not is a different question. As a lawyer, he is entitled to argue. Whether that will be accepted or not is a different question.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Point taken. You are as humorous as you were when you were an Asian session judge. I remember when I came for a bail in a rape case before you asked the prosecutor, how is the investigation? Then investigation has progressed. Then you asked the prosecutor, is the weapon completely exam.
Tested. The weapon of offense tested. Instead of asking whether the potency test is over or not, he asked him whether the weapon of offense has been tested.
Yes. Yes, thank you, sir. Wonderful experience.
Thank you,
sir. Sir, we have a couple of judicial officers also here. I think Manjula ma'am is here. Manjula, please. She want to leave also, I think. She's getting out of the office, I believe.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, right now I am facing the same situation. There are petitions for tendering pardon. And I have also files before me in which magistrates have already tendered pardon. And it
what
is
stage?
Before
what stage? Stage is important. At what stage?
Is during investigation stage.
Magistrate granted pardon.
A petition was forwarded to this court and my predecessor in office sent that to the Metropolitan Magistrate, Chief Metropolitan Magistrate, and one of the Metropolitan Magistrates recorded the statement and they sent that to this court after a recorded pardon.
Cannot.
That is wrong. Actually, during investigation stage, the FIR and every documents will be in my court only because it is there is no committal proceedings. FIR will be filed before the special court in PC Act cases.
Nothing wrong. But if there is a pardon to be tendered, the matter should go before the CJM in a non-metropolitan area or any metropolitan magistrate.
Okay. I have to send this application to the Metropolitan Chief Metropolitan Magistrate.
Not necessarily. Any metropolitan magistrate will do. But if it is a non-metropolitan area, the Chief Judicial Magistrate. I stressed that point in the section. Is the section?
Yes.
The Chief Judicial Magistrate or a Metropolitan Magistrate.
Okay.
See the word. See the difference in phraseology.
Because we have here we have 17th additional Metropolitan Magistrate, which is dealing with exclusively with PC Act cases.
Okay.
So it would be better for me to send to any to that court and he records the statement and he sends back.
No, he has to tender pardon.
Tender pardon.
And then the case has to come to you by way of a committal.
So he has to commit the case.
Yes, under section 306(5)(a)(2).
That's what I'm telling. The whole record will be with me, FIR, the other documents. So
you have to send it to the CJM.
Everything has to be sent.
Yes. And then the charge sheet will have to be filed before the magistrate competent to commit the case to the special judge, who is also deemed to be a session judge, court of session, under section 5(3).
Actually, to which magistrate I'm sending this, he is not a competent magistrate under section PC.
He need not be the committing magistrate. He should not be. The tender of pardon should be by Chief Judicial Magistrate in a non-metropolitan area or any metropolitan magistrate in a metropolitan area. After tendering pardon, the metropolitan magistrate should forward the case for entire case files to the magistrate who is entitled to commit the case to the court of session under section 306(5)(a)(2).
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Sir, we have one another judicial officer, Rajakumara, sir, please.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. He is a very bright officer. He may overrule me.
Editor, follow, sir.
Yes, you can say that if I am wrong.
Sir, just a doubt because it is a new subject for me. I have never dealt with that act.
Are you special judge under the PC Act?
Sir?
Are you a special judge? Are you a special judge?
POCSO Act, sir. Under the POCSO Act.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Earlier, I was the special judge in NDPS court.
Okay.
Sir, by reading 4A, I find I want some clarification from you, sir. Guidance. It says, shall be examined as a witness in the court of the magistrate, taking cognizance of the offense in the subsequent trial, if any.
And in the subsequent trial. he shall be examined as a witness before the magistrate taking cognizance of the offense, and also in the subsequent trial. And there is an and. You have missed an and.
I think it is not there in my book. Sorry. Maybe some print mistake. Okay. Shall be examined as a witness in the court of the magistrate, and
in the subsequent trial.
And in the subsequent trial. So taking cognizance of the offense, that means the magistrate who can examine the approver,
yes,
should be the magistrate who is competent to take cognizance
and commit the case to the special court.
So he must be the person having the competency to take cognizance.
If pardon is tendered during the stage of investigation.
Investigation, yes.
Not otherwise.
So the special court has... It has the right to take cognizance on committal.
On committal, if it is under fire. Otherwise, have you heard of a special judge taking cognizance on a committal? But yeah, if the pardon is tendered during investigation, there is a special procedure. That is beautifully said in 2016, AIA 2016 Supreme Court 255, what? Arul Kumar. I think that is Justice Sikri. I think Judge Sikri. Probably Premraj. Premraj will be able to say.
Okay. Justice Sikri.
Ready, Reckoner.
And then, is there any provision for dealing with the bail applications by the special judge, sir?
During crime stage?
Yeah, because after the first remand, going by 167 of CRPC,
yes,
if the magistrate is not having the power to take cognizance,
yes,
it has to be, he has to remand, I mean, he has to send the accused to the concerned judge, I mean, special, yes, judge or other magistrate.
Only for granting bail. Granting bail only.
In that case, the special judge has to remand the accused.
Not necessarily. Even the magistrate can remand, because he need not be the jurisdictional magistrate, even under the IPC offences.
That is for the first period of remand, 15
but
days.
But once he entertains a doubt whether he should be remanded again, then he can send it only to the jurisdictional court for granting bail. That court alone can grant bail.
In that way, the special judge has got the right to grant bail also.
Yes. Special judge alone. Special judge alone can see 167. Please read 167. Now, you may clear that doubt also. Now that you are in my study. See the wording of 167.
The magistrate to whom an accused person is forwarded under this section may, whether he has or has not jurisdiction to try the case,
yes,
from time to time, to authorize the detention of the accused in such custody as such magistrate thinks fit, for a term not exceeding 15 days.
Whether he has jurisdiction or not.
Sure, sir. Yes. Sure.
Then,
for a term not exceeding 15 days in the whole. And if he has no jurisdiction to try the case or commit for trial,
and considers further detention unnecessary,
he may order the accused to be forwarded to the magistrate having such jurisdiction. So instead of that magistrate, he has to be forwarded to the special judge.
Special judge.
Yeah, under the PC Act, is there any provision for applying the bail provision, sir? Is there any provision for...
There is no, I don't think there is any special provision for that.
So in the NDPS Act and other special statutes, we find that... The provisions regarding the bail and bail bonds shall be applicable to the special court also. But in the PCAC, I could not find such provision.
But PCAC 5, section 5.3, he is deemed to be a magistrate, but only for limited purpose. 326 and 475 CRPC.
So in the absence of such a specific provision, is it possible for the special judge to deal with the bail matters? That is my doubt. Or should it again go to the principal sessions court or the usual sessions division?
What is the procedure in Vogue now? Procedure in Vogue?
In PC Act, I am not aware of that aspect, sir. But in other special cases, special acts.
No, PC Act, I don't think that it is coming to the sessions courts. Normally, it will not come.
Because that is a trial court, jurisdiction court. PC Act special judge is a jurisdiction court. It can remand, it can grant bail also. But magistrate who gave the initial remand, he cannot grant bail.
Sir, but in the other acts, in the NDPS Act as well as in the other special acts, in POXO also, there is a specific provision which says that the provisions in the CRPC regarding bail and bail bonds shall apply to the special court also.
I don't know.
Such
I don't
provision think, is not seen in the PC Act.
I don't think, I don't know. I have not, I have been
affected. I think on the analogy that it is the sessions court,
yes,
all those provisions can be followed, I mean applied.
It is a trial court. It is a jurisdictional court. It is a court having jurisdiction. It can grant bail definitely. If it can grant bail, why can't remand it?
Sir.
Or remanding the accused.
My doubt arose because in the other two enactments, specific provision has been made. Applying the provisions of CRPC as to the bail and bail bonds.
Okay.
In the POXO Act as well as in the NDPS Act. But in PC Act, no such provisions are seen. Maybe they have to apply the general.
Not that. Probably because, as Ramkumar has earlier said, it has been constituted for the purpose of trial.
Right.
Sure.
Once it has been constituted for the purpose of trial, all the trappings of the trial court will come to that automatically.
And what is the position regarding SCST Atrocities Act? SCST Atrocities Act.
They're also same, sir.
Same.
Yes.
No, I think
the special acts provide that the special courts are established only for the purpose of trial.
Trial.
And the power of taking cognizance is also given without committal. At the same time, separate provision is
there. Provision is there. Now there is some connectivity problem for you.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for enlightening me. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Rajkumara, sir. Thank you for joining the platform. Yes, sir. We got Nawaz Jain, sir, with the hands, sir.
Really?
Sir, my doubt is with regard to the credibility of that witness who is being tendered pardon.
Yes.
Why the special judge is tendering a pardon? It is with a view to obtaining the evidence of any person who is supposed to have been directly or indirectly involved in it. Now the question is, how far can we rely upon the statement of that particular accused who was primarily involved in the committal of an offence?
He was a participant.
What is the role of the prosecutor in that?
He was a participant in the crime.
Yes, absolutely.
A participant in the crime. But at the same time, there can be situations where no direct evidence regarding the commission of heinous offences. I gave you the citation that 94 Supreme Court 2420.
Yes.
Supreme Court said there will be very heinous crimes might have been committed, and there will be a total dearth of evidence. Then you can only catch hold of, or rather, the investigating agency can only catch hold of a person having some relatively minor role in that crime. And so that if he is prepared to honestly give the
that is the problem. That honestly giving it. Now, for example,
see, the incentive for him is that he, from the rank of accused, he becomes a prosecution witness.
Approval.
He becomes a prosecution witness.
Prosecution.
He is exonerated.
But the person against whom he is making some disclosure, the accused against whom he is making a disclosure, will have every right to rebut the same, first of all.
Definitely.
Secondly, how far the court can rely on the statement of this particular person when he was earlier an accused and now turns to be an approver, probably because he was constrained to be so because of the torture of the investigating officer sometimes.
Not necessarily torture, there can be.
Maybe pressurized. Okay. The case that is in the limelight as of now in Kerala, we have seen that the accused was reluctant to confess anything, saying that the person was innocent. Now it has come to this stage that the person is ready to disclose the involvement of the accomplice in that. Now the question is, how far can we trust on that particular thing? Is it the duty of the prosecutor or the court magistrate? Special judge.
His evidence has to be approached like in the case as any other evidence. And 133, section 1, I think it is section 133, which says the evidence of an accomplice is also reliable evidence. Then it is 114 says that unless it is corroborated,
correct.
That is not a mandatory provision.
One more doubt, sir.
Yes.
Like in other cases, in the PC Act, when an accused is being tried by the special judge, is the accused entitled to approach the High Court under Section 483 for the expeditious disposal of his case? Can the accused approach the High Court?
What is 483?
For expeditious disposal. 483. I'm talking about the Prime knows it. It was Prime who told me a month ago about 483.
Superintendent.
Is it not 483, Prime?
Something analogous to 227, is not?
Yes,
you can say that. A poor cousin of 227.
The words.
Now, is the accused entitled to approach that court, sir? And in this case?
Section says only magistrate. Section says only magistrate. But why do you want a enabling provision? 226 is always there, or 482 is always there.
Yes.
227.
227 is there.
Yes, yes, yes.
You don't require any express provision. You don't require any express provision. Correct?
No. I was apprehensive of the credibility of the statement of these such witness. And if at all, once he turns to be an approver, at a later stage, if he retracts from his disclosure, then...
He will go back to the original position as an accused, that's all.
So he will no longer be a prosecution witness.
Yes, he can be re-arrested. And the retraction should come from the prosecutor's side. Prosecutor will have to certify that he has retracted from the...
That's what I was asking you. What is the role of the prosecutor?
Prosecutor has to certify, no? Yes.
50 Cent Supreme Court 637. Namaskar jo vache le. 57 Supreme Court 637 speaks about the double test. In the first instance, the court has to see whether that person is can be relied upon. Then the second test comes, whether that probative value of the evidence given by that person. That is a double test.
The entire gamut of the procedure has been detailed in one of my articles reported in 2018 KHC journal page 63. 2018 KHC page 63. Usually, in fact, that's a beautiful procedure in Tamil Nadu. When apart from 161 statement, his 164 statement is recorded, and then only the Chief Judicial Magistrate will record it, because the magistrate, the statement given to the police is no guidance for the magistrate. Therefore, 164 statement is recorded by a magistrate, and then only the pardon is tendered by the Chief Judicial Magistrate.
We are also using that same procedure. 164, then it goes to CJA.
It is attributable to Madras practice. It started in Madras. That is being followed by Kerala.
Maybe we are also following the same rules of practice.
Yes.
Madras rules we are following.
Even PI period, certification period, Madras.
No, that is applicable only in Malabar area. Madras rules were originally. Subsequently, now the criminal rules of practice.
As a guidance, we are following it. Even in non-Malabar area, it can be used as a guidance. Nothing wrong.
Sir, what is the procedure when the special judge has to follow when he is giving tendering pardon?
Whether the special court has
to record the statement of the approver. If the special judge is giving tendering pardon after cognizance.
Why can't he delegate the examination to a Chief Judicial Magistrate and then record the and then approve the tender the pardon?
There's no procedure is stated there.
Even otherwise, procedure is not there. That the Chief Judicial Magistrate should take the 164 statement first. Anganam procedure illa. We are only following the Madras practice. But therefore, it will be safer for the special judge when there is a request comes. Because at that stage, the investigating officer alone may not be the sponsoring authority. Investigating plus prosecution may be the sponsoring authority.
So
therefore, the special judge will have to can request a chief judicial magistrate to record or get a statement, 164 statement recorded through another magistrate and then forward it to so that he can act on that, on the credibility, etc.
So
like,
can the accused file an affidavit before the special court?
To what effect?
Saying that I'm ready to be an approver.
The courts have taken the view that that should not come from the accused. Ordinarily, it should not come from the accused. Should come from the investigating agency, or after committal, it can come from the prosecuting. Come investigate, and prosecuting agency should make the request after consulting the investigating agency. That is the view I have come across. Yes, anywhere I have gone wrong, Mr. Ralph, you are a very very learned practitioner.
Vandaram sir was adding something.
Sir, I only wanted to ask Ram Kumar sir, maybe slightly deviation.
Out of the way. Yeah.
Slight deviation.
Yes.
How effective is our prosecution or our prosecutors in Indian context? And where does the hitch lies in the Indian criminal jurisprudence, in the criminal side?
My experience in Calicut has been that those who were selected as prosecutors from the criminal side and civil side, those who were practicing on the civil side, when appointed as a prosecutor, they were doing better. That is my experience. than those who were practicing on the criminal side. We had that I don't remember his name. Jairam also, I don't remember, who was addicted to drinks and all. Particularly, his name, I don't recollect his name. He was doing very well. CBI court, I found a very, very, one or two good, very good prosecutors who were very thorough with the law and the procedure. And after all, you see, public prosecutor, leave alone special judge. Special judge, they are renamed as a legal advisor. And maybe to get over Sarla versus Velu, 2000 Supreme Court, where it was said that job of the prosecutor takes place inside the court. He has no power to give tender advice to the investigating officer. According to me, that decision should be overruled. You see, when a police officer is in doubt, whom else can he approach for legal opinion?
So not only. Is he not an is their advocate?
Yes, and it is he who approves the draft charge, etc. I don't know why that such a view has been taken. But it has.
No, sir, not Kerala versus Velu. This was again appealed in the Taj Corridor scam case. MC Mehta, rejects it.
But do you justify that? Do you approve that?
Because I have some presidential bias. I'm always biased.
See, the only legally trained person whom the police officer comes across is the public prosecutor. Why can't he give advice to the police officer? Or should he take the advice from a Supreme Court senior advocate by paying money from his pocket?
Investigation is the domain of the investigator. And what does a public prosecutor do? When does this duty come in?
Supposing investigating officer has got a genuine doubt regarding the procedure. Take for instance,
they are taking the entire final report to the concerned public prosecutor, and the prosecutor verifies the entire thing. And if there are shortcomings, he would just say there are these and these shortcomings. Then again, it goes back to the IU, and after all the rectification of all those shortcomings, it comes back.
But
if Sarla versus Velu is continue to be good law, how do you justify the renaming of the public prosecutor as a
legal advisor
in the PC Act special court?
I will tell you, because
there also he is a public prosecutor only.
Sarla versus Velu was the first case, then comes the 3-judge bench in MC Mehta, and finally 2014 you have another judgment by the 2-judge bench. I forgot the name of the ruling. In that particular ruling, what the Supreme Court goes on to say is, now after filing the final report, I mean, after submitting the delaying of the final report, if at all the prosecutor feels that there is something else which is required to be done, then he has to apply for further investigation and get that rectified.
But that is the prerogative of the police, not that of the public prosecutor.
So, but this is the only go which was held by the Supreme Court.
I have my own reservations about that view, because he can take legal advice only from the public prosecutor who is legally trained. And you are a public prosecutor. Were you not giving legal advice?
I was giving, definitely.
See, the only thing is that they need not give a written opinion.
They can safely avoid.
Endorsed, charged, approved. That is the practice which was deprecated in Sarla versus Wheeler. You cannot approve the charge.
Sir, we have Shoheb Hussain with a question. Shoheb, yes. Please.
Good evening, sir.
He usually asks very sensible questions.
I just try to learn, sir. I am a novice in criminal law, sir. So, subsection 2 is always overriding upon subsection 1 of 306.
No, subsection 2 is only the offenses to which this section applies.
Yes, sir. So, if that be so, sir, then in subsection 1, I do not understand why the legislature is contemplating this thing, that the magistrate of the first class inquiring into or trying the offense at any stage of the inquiry or trial, because the magistrate of the first class is only empowered to try the offense which are triable by the court of magistrate first, and second, they can inflict punishment up to 3 years maximum.
Yes.
So that be the provision, then why is the legislature contemplating these particular words that a magistrate, because the CJM has the power to award punishment up to 7 years. Yes. That is clear, sir. But yes. What about the scope of this magistrate of the first class?
See, that is because in the case of a magistrate who is at the stage of inquiry or trial, he can tender pardon and he can examine the approver under section 304, 306, 4A, and thereafter the trial should be by the CJM.
So it is not during the trial that the
during inquiry the... during inquiry or trial he can do that, but then the trial, even though section says during investigation, inquiry or trial, investigation, ordinary magistrate cannot tender pardon. Only CJM or metropolitan magistrate can tender pardon.
Yes, sir.
Investigation thing. But during inquiry or trial, the magistrate inquiring into or trying the case can tender pardon, but then the trial has to be by CJM as provided under section 305. A2, A, B.
Exactly, sir. Yes, sir, exactly. But then, sir, I mean, is the word trial in subsection 1 differing from that of subsection 5?
Because he has already tendered pardon, then he should not try the case, because he might be a prejudiced judge. He might be a prejudiced magistrate. Therefore, the law wants another magistrate to try the case. That is why 5A, A1, so the court of session, if the offense is tried by that court, or if the magistrate taking cognizance is the chief, I'm sorry, the court of, and B, 5B, subsection 5B, in any yes, other case, make over the case to the chief judicial magistrate who shall try the case himself. In any other case means, in cases not covered by A, not yes, covered sir. By A, the magistrate should make over the case to the chief judicial magistrate who shall try the case.
So the magistrate of the first class in subsection was cannot under any circumstances try the case. No. He can only just refer it to the CJM for trial.
5B. Subsection
5. That will override subsection 1.
Definitely.
Yes, yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shoheb. And if anything else to be added by Jaimon or Rolf?
Sir, I'm just telling it was excellent. It was a new learning. Totally new subject. I, of course, not ordinarily come across, but I have two doubts. One was regarding the approver. See, you are telling that he is like any other witness. But yes. I think he
not my view. It is view of the Supreme Court.
And I am telling. I'm just telling. No, I'm not criticizing that. So, but according to me, he should be the court should be more vigilant on
definitely, definitely.
Because, see, we're taking instances, one person is accused for person is poised as the main accused for quite long time, and yes. Suddenly when he or she is into trouble, he is turning around and helping prosecution. What they are yes. So that yes. that be the case, there should be triple checking. Not double checking, according to me. According to me, the circumstances under which he is accused and consented to be an accused also has to be proved by the court. That is
why even though under section 133 an accomplice is a competent witness, the rider has been added. The 114 illustration. Therefore, unless corroborated, courts generally don't.
According to me, the witness has to be dealt more carefully than a chance witnesses, because chance witnesses can be a chance yes. witnesses sometimes. The witness regarding witness, I am telling. So lot of cases in NDPA cases when we are dealing with the ordinary district courts. Thomas B. Joseph was the presiding of the additional district judge in Kerala. One witnesses was coming any time. So what we are doing, I was a junior to a prosecutor that time.
We were
changing the witness. One witness will be examined. So this case, somebody is examined, then the other court we will examine. So one case, we don't have any other option. Second case of the same witness exam. So was produced as a witness. Then he immediately said, "Enda hai, ningal evada thirinjalum kanjavu kuduthanu."
Pocket witness.
And
police.
And most interestingly, most of the cases, Nadakkal police, all the
Kasaba, then Kasaba people also.
And I will tell you, one telephone post near West Hill Industry, either 130 meters towards east or towards west. In West Hill Industrial Estate, one telephone post number is the stock number. So these are the kind
that Ram Kumar sir, on the lighter vein, West Hill area, this Kanjav business was completely stopped by removing that telephone post.
I heard that Pallikandi.
I think there is a Bangladesh colony or Pakistan colony.
All has now improved a lot.
It's Shantinagar colony. Name is Bangladeshi settlements. Now I think there it is stopped. Almost that sale is stopped. And yes. this is the system. Now these kind of witnesses we are dealing. And the second question the Kodandram sir was asking about the prosecutors. That very interesting. We have to discuss another topic, because I was also prosecutor for a shorter period, less than 2 years only, in 2007 to 2009. And I find it very interesting, because the prosecutors, after getting the job of prosecutor or appointed or whatever, we are not claiming you are stopped working. You are stopped using your brain. You don't
vaccinated against legal information.
Absolutely. Yeah. Completely insulated.
And one other system is that when the courts are increased, now new courts are coming, the police system, keeping of files, that also so the special courts will will be dealing with fast track courts, special courts. They when they are established, the prosecutors will get the file only 1 or 2 days before the starting of files. That time only they will came to know if you are applying some mind also.
As in the case of High Court GPs.
Yeah, that's exactly. Not High Court GPs also in Kerala, in Supreme Court also, ASGs and standing councils, main standing councils, they are assigned on the previous day only. I don't know, two and they were coming with and three or four, 4 or 5, 6 to 7 matters, and they used to come 3-4 volume matters, three volume, 200 pages or 600 pages matters in 2 minutes. Means 1 or 2 hours they are coming. So that is something else. Yes, sometimes, but and this system require a serious what do you revisit, because nobody is interested in that. I don't understand. There should be it is a need of an hour to have a single system or uniform system all over the country, and and a prosecution directorate in proper sense. Otherwise, you see, I am not against any political. See, those who are appointed as political appointees are bad. I don't say, but there are bad persons also, and those who are appointed by merit also, they are very good. That is, I don't have an endorsement.
There are political refugees as well.
Yes, that is a fact. I know. I am not saying that. I know. Even in the High Court, Ralph sir may be knowing, there are ground breeders who never came to office. Even not attended a single day. That too happened during this time. I don't understand. There was severe criticism against. We all know who was there. So that is not my question. And the I don't know. The legislature also not giving much importance to the prosecution. Is a very important very important part of the criminal justice system. And I fully endorse with Ramkumar sir that police prosecutor should advise and they are not they see advice can be two ways. Advice can be said after reading the charge, we can advise that you find out some witness to fulfill lacuna and come back.
Plant a section 27 recovery. That is not the advice.
Yeah, you make some you find out somebody and come back. That is an advice. That is not an advice. Actually, that is a crooked way of doing that. You are not supposed to do. But suppose in the case of Soumya case, the when it came before Supreme Court, the main issue was that the person who speaking out the register was not questioned. So now suppose that I am taking it as an example. And he was the I don't know seasoned prosecutors, but they were not even in the Supreme Court also they were not agreeing when Justice Lalit and all of them are telling the importance of such a witness. When you are saying that such a person is there, you have to so they are not fully understanding that. But it that similar circumstances coming having the person supposed to be know the law. We are the prosecutor supposed to tell them there is you are mentioning about a person, you go and find out him. If it is not that, you make all the this is the proper legal advice. These legal advices should come from where else they go.
Yes.
I know there are some good prosecutors, good investigating officers or police officers who are going to private lawyers for taking advice in Calicut.
Yes, Mr. Andrews. Sorry, Mr. Ramkumar, sir, I'm leaving here because somebody is coming.
Okay, thank you. I fully endorse it, sir. Thank you, sir.
And what do you say about the appointment of prosecutors by the ministry concerned? And they are co-terminus with the ministry. Justice can you expect from them?
No, that I was telling. I am not saying that all the persons appointed by the governments are
on the contrary. Bad.
And I don't endorse to the fact that all the those who are selected on merits also and merit selection also we have
taking classes in the Judicial Academy, I have noted that APPs are more sharp, more well knowledgeable, more well informed than PPs.
That is happening. That's what I'm telling. There are instances when the persons who never went to court also appointed as prosecutors. We have experience in even in our there are allegations also with the person, and that's what I'm telling. In the
High Court, it should not be the casualty. Merit should not be a guarantee.
Sir, like Justice Gordon Ram sir has initiated or introduced the topic, I think we require a session on which, I mean, we had a discussion on desirability of having a good, what do you call, capital punishment, or which would be the best for our country and things like that. Why can't we also have a discussion and deliberation on this topic? The prosecution system in the country, how far it is effective,
and how far study it is, also should be there. According to me,
there should be a study. There should be somebody who should initiate that.
See, there are British, English prosecution system. There are different prosecution systems. So that may not be suitable for us in fully, but still we can have a that's what I'm telling. These sort of things. How you, the way you are advising is the bad thing. But suppose, but if some police officers are ill informed, then it is your prosecutor's duty to correct them. Who else they will do? Otherwise, yeah. There should be permanent legal officers appointed in the police department, and they will be. They are also salary persons. They will stop reading KLT on the day when they are getting appointment. That is that's a take that. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you,
Dhiman. We need honest
citizens. Contra, sir?
Finally, we need honest citizens.
Yeah, exactly.
Judiciary onwards, everywhere.
I have always been advocating that. What is lacking is basic honesty in our system.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely.
Sir, I just will share one more. Sham, 2 minutes. So 1 minute.
No, absolutely no issue, sir. Please go
ahead. No. On that contest, I wanted to share with everyone. There's a very interesting book written by Professor Raghunathan, an IIM professor and behavioral scientist.
Okay.
The IIM professor, the book name is The Games Indians Play. Why the Indians Behave the Way They Behave. And then conclusion which he draws is, Indian citizens are most dishonest. And for everything, they look for their personal gain rather than the community gain.
Exactly. That is precisely 150 years ago, the Privy Council said that.
Yes. Now he realized that it has come and how it has come. And the effort not being made by the gentry or for the society to encourage the honesty and to encourage that thing. Maybe because we have given up. You know, I was reading I've been hearing a lot of old poems in Telugu, you know, just like in Malayalam also there, Sanskrit also there, in what we call it as Satakams. Sumati Satakam, Vemana Satakam, Bhaskara Satakam, Nrisimha Satakam, where the truths of the society and how the societal behavior is being
reflected,
inculcated from a child at the age of, from the age of 5th year. By way of poems and by way of proverbs, etc.
Yes.
Unfortunately, in today's in this English education system, we have completely lost.
The joint family system had that advantage. Elders used to advise the younger generation.
I request whoever is interested, just read that thing.
I will.
It's just 250 pages.
Where is it available in the ordinary bookshop?
Yeah, it's available in bookshop or even on the online Amazon.
Okay.
In fact, it was being sold at 250 rupees or 300 rupees.
It starts from the the childhood, in the sense like a child is being chastised by the father for not getting something done out of the way. Then. Mm-hmm. The message goes, you know, everybody could do it, you can't do it, you could have done it. Instead of trying to praise him for standing his ground and not getting some temporary, what you call, benefits, he'll be asked to say that you won't survive in this world, you're not fit to be in this part of this world, you should learn all this. So there it starts. So we have Jain sir with a question. Jain sir, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, it was a wonderful session, Ram Kumar sir. But I strongly differ with Jaimon Andrews. Remarks on prosecutors. There are good prosecutors also, sir. Then, only one thing, sir. I had an occasion when a circle inspector of police sought a legal opinion with respect to registering a crime against his another circle inspector. The prosecutor has written the legal opinion that if you feel that any cognizable offense is revealed to you, you can register a crime. So that is a way for each and every reason when they come for a legal opinion, such a legal opinion will be given by the prosecutor, sir.
Maybe he's a political refugee.
That I don't know, sir. But I had an occasion by hearing that he told that it was the opinion was given that if you feel that a cognizable offense is revealed, you can register a crime.
See, this foil system should change. CRPC section 24.4, that foil system should change. Because that has been deprecated by the Americans. Foil system has been totally stopped. But unfortunately, in section 24 CRPC, we have got that foil system. Ministry appointing persons. In fact, when I was the law secretary,
yes.
Rules of business says, appointing the public prosecutor or government pleader in the district, matter should be taken to the Council of Ministers, Cabinet. I said public prosecutor will include additional public prosecutor also. The minister said, don't introduce such unnecessary controversy. We have been appointing public prosecutor, main principal public prosecutors only by taking it to the cabinet. Additional public prosecutors are appointed by the minister concerned. Don't introduce unnecessary controversy. This was the answer given to me by the law minister.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, thank we you, have Ajit, sir. Please, sir, you put the hands up.
Sir, I want to add up, sir, I want to very seriously dispute what Mr. Kodan has. But sir, Indians, it is wrong to say that we are descendants. This is the land of Shivaji. This is the land of that great Chakravarti who gave a piece of flesh from his thigh bone, from his thigh, for the purpose of doing justice. It is like spitting on our own faces.
How many Shivajis do we have?
Sir, it is spitting on our faces. It is wrong.
No, it is.
We are a great country. We are a great country. We are a great nation. We are a great people. We are much better than the foreigners. It is not for the British to teach us honesty. We have it, which is inborn to us.
That's where I said Britishers have taught us the dishonesty.
That's right.
That is still in our system.
We have been corrupted. In fact, the analysis in the book is that only. We have gone to that meanest level is.
Sir, may make a submission.
Sir.
Yes, sir. Just think of the history of Guru Gobind Singh. His disciple was brought, and he was skinned alive, and he was given the choice that you convert to Islam, nothing will happen to you. He was skinned alive. Then he was put in the boiling water, oil, and then he was put to death. Then Guru Gobind Singh asked whether you will convert to Islam. Then he said, Mr. Aurangzeb, even if you agree to marry your daughter to me, I will not do it. Then both his eyes were scooched out. Then he was cut to death. We are living in such a country of such honest, great men.
Sir, that is the problem, sir. The whole dishonesty aspect is the present generation we are talking about, not with regard to our history or not with regard to what my grandfather has done. In fact, you know, the entire of this thing is it's the last 100 years or 150 years, how it has been degenerated.
No, sir, I will tell you.
To such an extent, society.
No, sir, if it is the present generation.
Because that's a big debate.
Sir, no. Sir, let us not enter into your quarrel. You said over the present generation. Take Raghuram Rajan, very honest person. Huh? Like that, you can. I will give you hundreds of examples. Even Mr. Ram Kumar, who is sitting in front of you, is a very good friend of yours.
Don't include me.
You are mistaken.
Anybody? No, it's not like that. Present generation is also very good.
No, sir. I agree with you. In fact, it's because. At the same time, if you look at the overall, the society is the what I'm talking about, not about Ram Kumar sir or yourself or myself or my
Raghuram Rajan.
Or Raghuram Rajan. No, I'm not on the individual levels. So the very fact that you need to name few itself that you are eliminating the society. That is what I'm saying. It is a general society quality which you are talking. In fact, with respect to in all other countries, one important aspect from the criminal justice point of view, you know, in US or in UK or Australia, in any other country, one of the most serious offenses is speaking a lie in a court.
Yes.
Or anywhere. Now you tell me with regard to your Indian courts or Indian system or this thing, day in and day out, right from the police officer to the witnesses, both sides, and people not coming forward to give evidence, or when they give evidence, they come and speak, tutored evidence, tutored this one. They have no value for the truth.
See, even in the case of...
The society has gone. In fact, other day we had this discussion with regard to perjury. The court's not in the invoking the perjury.
195, section 195.
Yes.
Yes.
Next, sir.
Case of American president, having extramarital affair was not the offense, but telling a lie.
Yes. Correct.
Sir, we are, to a great extent, we also agree with Ajit sir, but the issue is that earlier we could say the society as such was truthful. Now we require names to be spelt out to say that we have some truthful persons in our society. That is the only difficulty. Otherwise, it would have been just wonderful. As we come to the end of 155th session,
Rice has sought for permission to ask some question. Mr. Rice.
Please, he is here. Yeah, please, go ahead.
Your question will be answered to the best of my information, knowledge, and belief capacity. Yes.
May I audible, sir?
Yes.
You are audible.
Yes, sir. My doubt is that when it is stated that under section 306, 4 CRPC, the accomplice has to be examined before the magistrate. My doubt is that whether the accused has got a right of cross-examination at that stage.
In fact, if you refer to my article, detailed article, 2018 KHC Journal, page 63, I have given all those instances. In fact, today, Mr. Shyam Padman has screened that chart. You just go through the chart. In the chart, I have given every possible situation. Supposing the accused are present in court pursuant to some process. If the accused are present in court pursuant to process, that is precisely what Justice Butt corrected his own earlier view by saying that if the accused are present pursuant to process, because they... pardon can be tendered at any stage, investigation, inquiry or trial. Therefore, if at the time of granting pardon and examination under section 306-4A, the accused are present, you can't deny an opportunity to cross-examine them. Cross-examine you cannot deny them the opportunity to cross-examine the approver. In fact, there is one or two rulings of the Supreme Court saying that the other accused have no right to cross-examine. Not strictly correct, because if, for example, in a warrant trial private complaint, Kerala High Court, a single judge of the Kerala High Court said that, as in the case of a 200 examination, if the accused happens to be present, he cannot cross-examine. In a warrant trial, pre-charge examination, pre-charge questioning, the single judge. But there are two rulings, if I remember correct, there are two rulings of the Supreme Court which said that, if the accused happened to be present pursuant to process, once you issue process, he has a right to participate in the trial, unlike in the 200 examination. 200 examination takes place at the pre-process stage, whereas if the examination of the approver under section 306-4A, he is at the post-process stage in the presence of the accused. I am of the view that they should be given an opportunity to process. Whether they avail it or not, different thing.
So what would be the effect of such a process examination? There need not be any appreciation of that evidence.
Exactly. They will be acting wiser by cross examining them, as in the case of private complaint warrant trial. 244.
Sir, Ajita CGS put the hand up.
Yes.
Yeah, please.
Sir, good evening, sir. The, with regard at the during discussion, sir thought all that one decision rendered by Justice U.L. but my lord.
Yes.
That is.
Please refer to my detailed article in 2018 KHC Journal.
Yes. Yes.
63.
Yes. Yes.
That
yes.
was all the decision. Justice, but earlier decision. And he corrected and himself.
That is
Mark Lee scandal case. Monu Surendran versus Monu Surendran.
1981 KLP 53.
Here is our ready reckoner.
Okay. He himself has corrected the decision.
Yes. He said that I was wrong. In fact, yes. It was Mr. Kunjirao Menon who argued. And accepting the argument of Kunjirao Menon, he said... They have no right to cross-examination. Subsequently, he corrected himself by saying that I was wrong. In fact, when the accuser present, they have a right to cross-examination.
That is also reported.
That is also from the same Mark Lee scandal, but at a different stage,
involving
other accused.
Yes.
Anthony
yes,
also. Kurian versus
yes.
State of Kerala.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Achyuta. Thank you. So, sir, I think no more hands are up, no more. Yes. So, over to you, Prince.
Well, Ramkumar, sir, it was fantastic because when you are on the lead, actually, we get a very lot of learning. And regarding what Ajita asked about the Monu Surendran and Kurian, I think that it was reported to a full bench, which you had answered that. Ashokan was the state of Kerala, 2005 2 KLJ 700.
Mm-hmm.
It was your own ruling.
Yes.
Where it was held that the approver, when he is examined before the magistrate, the accused has no right to cross examine him.
Following Supreme Court.
Following the Supreme Court judgment.
Yes. But then that is a case where Section 33 of the Evidence Act could be applied. The opportunity and the right. Both should be there. So I said, even if they had a right, they had no opportunity because he had died. He died in the meanwhile.
Because a person has, he had died. Correct. That was good. And sir, let me ask you another question. Can a special judge ignore a pardon which is tendered by a magistrate? And can the special
during judge investigation grant a during what stage?
During the stage of investigation, the magistrate grants pardon. Now the case comes up for trial. Can the special judge totally ignore that pardon granted by the magistrate? And can the special judge grant a fresh pardon to some other accused?
You have put me in a
situation. Also, even though it may appear to be too hypothetical, but it can also happen.
But should he not give reasons? Why he is discarding the pardon granted by the magistrate? Because
suppose we take it like this.
And see, normally pardon is tendered to one or maximum one or two. In the 2016 Supreme Court, five accused persons. Five persons.
Correct.
During the trial, if the material comes to the notice of the trial judge, that just like any other accused has also to be, somebody has been missed out and they are also to be brought into the prosecution.
Probably is it not such case?
Suppose, say, maybe rare, but the sessions judge, in the process of examining the, because he is the one who is holding the trial.
May I answer that?
Oh, yes.
Yes, sir. We are looking for the answer.
sir, Mr. Prem's question is very clear. That question can be answered in the light of this matter. That is, once pardon is granted, pardon can be cancelled only if the approver does not obey the conditions. So there has to be a violation.
Not only that, and merely because the session judge public prosecutor should certify.
Yes, certify that. Without that, the session judge has no jurisdiction to touch him. Without that, the session judge, the special judge has no jurisdiction to touch him. The special judge may grant as many pardons as he wants in exercise of the power under section 307, but those pardons and those approvals shall be in addition to the approval which is already granted by the during the stage of investigation. So therefore, my lord, the position is this. I give money to the investigating officer, I am secured.
then Mr. just take down this ruling. AG2 Criminal Law Journal 517. Just take down this ruling.
Yes.
This happened and it was observed that the special judge can ignore. Take down this ruling.
What is the page number? Page number?
517.
Which court? Supreme Court. Vijay, tell me one second.
AG2 Criminal Law Journal 517.
AG2 Criminal Law Journal?
517.
Thank you.
High Court. Oh. Because, see, the thing is that, as Ajit, you may be knowing, because here we have the CGM code. So 480, 468, everything is being tried there, except the PC Act offenses. And sometimes you see, there is an element of PC Act offense. And by the time the trial starts, then only we see that this offense also was there. And the matter has to be automatically, it has to be transferred. I mean, it has to be made over to the sessions court. Then what happens to the previous pardon? You can think it like that.
Yes, yes.
That is why I asked it like that.
Anyway, that is a very brilliant question.
As he is. I mean,
definitely. Yes, great.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. We got a lot of learning. And in fact, that Ananda Narayan, but actually that also, that was a case which was argued by me during 2009.
Yes.
And this particular position was canvassed, this Pascal's case. And that really answered it well. Butt's case, I think Ralph will remember, because you were also were appearing for one of the other accused.
Yes.
You remember, right? Some bank fraud. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, we come to the end of the 155th Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. Sir, thank you very much, Ramkumar sir. And I would say that the way you are handling the session and the way in which the entire platform interacted, and that itself shows, sir, how academically oriented all our members are, and they would like to have their doubts clarified, and that too by the different district judges as well. They all chipped in. That was wonderful, sir. I mean, if presentation could evoke such a response, I'm sure that more presentations and on more topics, there'll be more debates, deliberations, and that would definitely augur well with the way in which the legal system or the justice dispensation machinery can be enriched. But we are also thankful for the presence of Justice Kodandaram, sir, Justice Ramakrishnan, sir, and all the judicial officers who are present today, and all of you who participated, interacted, and made this platform enriched and a part of empowerment. I would say that till we meet again tomorrow in the 156th session, where we'll again see another aspect of intellectual property. The faculty who had introduced yesterday's geographical indications is a speaker tomorrow, Mr. Biju Komak. He'll be dealing with a special topic, that is intellectual property rights or intellectual protection under the Designs Act 2000. So let us design ourselves in such a manner that our intellect, whatever remains of it, is protected properly and preserved. Let us, from geographical indication to how an approver has to be handled, tomorrow we will go to Designs Act. So till we meet again tomorrow, 4:30, please sir, tomorrow it's evening, 4:30, the speaker wanted to be in the evening. So Sunday evening, 4:30, till we meet again. Please do take care and stay safe. And a special thanks to Rolf and S.K. Premraj, because they were involved in two of the cases which we dealt with. It is really wonderful to know that our platform has got those persons who can have the first information of what's transpiring in court. Thank you. Thank you.